Hey guys, welcome back to my channel. This is the Littlebean and Me podcast channel. My name's Kayleen and I'm your host. And today I'm just bringing you a quick video just to say hey and to catch up. I'm taking this brief opportunity while my son is napping to do some work and to also answer one of your questions. So I wanted to answer one of the most frequently asked questions that I receive, bar none, in terms of the most asked question by non-yarn dyers. So people who are not currently in the business of dyeing yarn or anything like that. The question that I receive all the time is, what are your tips for starting a yarn business? And do you recommend that I dye yarn? Or I'm thinking about dyeing yarn, but I'm not sure if I want to make the commitment type of questions. So I wanted to answer this in a little bit, not to be a Debbie Downer, but to say that if you're interested in dyeing yarn, that's fantastic. You definitely should do it. If it's something that you're interested in doing and you want to get into the field of yarn dyeing and fiber arts, then you should totally do it. Start a knitting shop or starting a design page, becoming a knitwear or crochet designer. Any of those things, including dyeing yarn, fall under this umbrella, and it is what I'll be talking about. So for those of you wondering, yes, you should start a business. If you want to start a business, if it's something that you enjoy doing, it's something that you're doing for fun for yourself right now, and you're interested in expanding, I definitely recommend doing it. There are a few caveats that I want to talk about in terms of how to get into the fiber arts business. So the first thing I want to talk about is being yourself and doing it for the right reasons. And by that, I mean going in with appropriate expectations. So if you're a consumer of the wonderful fiber arts world, whether you purchase indie dyed yarn like mine, or you are, purchasing knitwear patterns, or you're an avid knitter or crocheter or weaver, you know that there are so many people in this field, and there are so many types of designers and types of dyers, different types of yarn, different purposes. You know, if you're a spinner, you know there are, you know, a ton of variety. There's a ton of variety in terms of what you can purchase as a consumer for roving. And so what I mean by being yourself is finding your place. Where do you see yourself when you start your business? Where do you want to be? For me, I knew when I began this podcast, and when I started my business over a year and a half ago, I knew that I wanted to fill a void that I saw, that I felt like I was part of in the fiber arts world, which was creating yarns that crocheters would also like to use that aren't just meant for knitters. and by that, I mean things that aren't necessarily pooling yarns and yarns that aren't necessarily self-striping, more along gradients or variegated or tonals that would be appealing both to knitters and crocheters, but could be used easily in crochet. So for me, that was my reason, and that was my why I started my business. I liked dyeing yarn. I liked using yarn. I liked discovering new things about yarn. Those are all the things for me personally that fueled it. So if you're sitting there and you're thinking, well, I feel like I could make a good living dyeing yarn, or I don't know if I could make an impact in the field because it is so densely populated, you know, just think about where do you see yourself in this whole spectrum of, you know, yarn and fiber, knitting and crocheting, weaving, spinning, that whole fiber art spectrum. Where do you see yourself, and where do you see yourself going in the next 5 years or 10 years? You know, do you love knitwear design? Do you feel like, oh, maybe there's something I could contribute to the fields, or a new design theme, or, you know, I want to start a podcast? You can do those things, but do it for yourself and do it for the reasons that you want, not for reasons that you think other people would want. Because your brand and your product and your reputation are all based on you. So for me, it's important to maintain that and to run my business with integrity and with respect and with kindness, because those are all things that are very important to me. So that's the first thing is, you know, think of it as an extension of yourself. And you should think of yourself first when you're starting your business and what you want to see come out of it. Where do you want to be? Where do you see yourself in the whole spectrum? The next thing I would say is that you should take it very seriously. If it is really something you want to do, it's not like your grandmother's idea of what a successful business should be. You know, we're coming in this whole generation. You know, I'm on the cusp between, you know, generation, like the millennials and Generation X. So we're kind of like in the middle here. Like at least my age demographic. So I'm in my early 30s. I'm not quite a millennial. I'm not quite Gen X. So, you know, we are the ones who are coming out into this market. And if you feel like you want to make a career for yourself in the art realm, whether it's fiber arts or regular arts, you should definitely do it. You don't need a college degree to dye yarn or design knitwear. And you can be very successful, but you need to know how to work your business, and you have to take it very seriously. If you want to start designing knitwear, then you should treat it as if it is fun, but also a job, and you have goals for yourself, and you understand how you can use social media to your advantage, or how you're going to reach your target demographic. Who do you want to reach with your product, or your design, or your fiber, or your yarn? You know, you want to take it seriously as a business, and you want to drive it forward with the anticipation that you want to be successful. So that means a few things. It means putting in money, putting in time, and putting in the effort to make something that other people would enjoy as well. So that's another thing. So one, do it for yourself and have a realistic expectation about where you fit in and where you want to be. And two, treat it like a business and treat it really seriously. If you want to make a career out of it, you can. There's nothing stopping you, and there's nothing stopping me either. I'm still growing as a business. And people message me all the time. They say, you're so successful and you're this. You guys see a very small portion of my life. You see a very small portion of, you know, my business. So I have a number of sales on Etsy right now. For being in a business for a year and a half and to have over 1,200 sales is something that is astounding to me. I never, ever, 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 ever thought that within that span of time I would have as many sales as I do. Or even here on YouTube, I've grown my channel from nothing, and now I have over 2,000 subscribers, which I do want to do a giveaway, so please stay tuned for that. But that comes with hard work and consistency and really enjoying what I do and putting aside the time when I can to do it. So do it for yourself. Have a realistic expectation. Take your business seriously. The next thing I would want to say is that you should look inward for inspiration. It's great to follow dyers, and it's great to follow other podcasters or other people that you find inspiring, but you don't want to draw your inspiration for your designs, for your fiber, for your yarn from other people. I get asked quite often if I can replicate other dyers' work, which I don't. I can look at a yarn and see how it's dyed, and I can look at the colors and know about which colors have been used. But there's an ethical line that some people don't really see when it comes to creating new colorways or creating individual pieces of work. So for me, when I'm drawing inspiration in my business, I draw it from things that I love. Hence my business name, which is Littlebean Loves Hand-Painted Yarn. It's something I love. It's incorporating the things, the places, the movies, the games. Everything that I enjoy in my life is where I draw my inspiration. I like to see new trends, so I do follow some other designers and I follow some other dyers who are either friends of mine or who are kind of on the cusp of the trends so that I know what's coming up. If there are very large pattern launches or knit-alongs, I can come at it ahead of the game. So that is where I look for inspiration. But I never look for inspiration for colorways based on other people's work. So meaning if I'm following other dyers, I'm not looking to their work for inspiration. Like I don't see their work and go, oh, I can do that too, and then replicate it. It's not ethical to do that. It just brings down the entire community comes down because of that. So when you're looking for inspiration, look inside yourself. What do you like? What colors do you like? I only use bases that I would knit or crochet with, or if I wove, if I used weaving tools, if I was a weaver, well, technically I am a weaver. My last name is Weaver. Legally still, yes, Weaver, but I don't weave. So I spin, I knit, I crochet. So I don't take in products or use colors that I would not use myself. I do dye colors that I might not necessarily enjoy, but I know that other people do enjoy. But I try to keep it about me and about what I feel is important and what I think is high quality, because I'm not about making money. Like I'm not about, what's the word I'm looking for? I'm not out for gains. I'm out for enrichment of the fiber arts world. That's my business goal and that's my model. And you have to find that out for yourself in building your own business. What is your motto? Are you there because your goal is to just become as big as humanly possible? Or is it you want to reach a certain target, or you want to have a podcast, or you want to do tutorials? You know, every person has their own viewpoint on what is important in a business. So for me, I draw inspiration from within, from the things I like, and I always keep my mission in mind, which is to dye pretty things that other people would really like to use and to bring inspiration to the fiber arts world at large, and to share things that I love that you might love too. So that's another really important thing. So do it for yourself. Take your business seriously. Find inspiration from within, not from others. Don't copy other people's work. Don't try and emulate other people. You're not that person. You are yourself. And in that same token, you shouldn't compare yourself to other people. This is the hardest, most difficult thing, challenging thing for me personally, is not to compare myself to other people. I'm very hard on myself when it comes to my work. I'm hard on myself. I'm a parent, so I'm always very down on myself, you know, not feeling worthy enough. But you have to compare yourself to yourself. Have goals in mind. Set them for yourself. Don't look at what other people are doing. Don't look at other people's sales. Don't look at other people's successes and then internalize them as your own. You create your own success and you create your own push forward. So keeping that in mind is super, 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 super important. And then the last thing I want to say is that you need to value yourself. And I know a lot of this video has seemed like, well, it's all about you. Well, technically it is. It's your business. But you want to value yourself. In the fiber arts world, it is so incredibly common and really sad that we don't value our own time. Knitting, crocheting, spinning, weaving, creating these things from hand takes an enormous amount of time, effort, and creativity. You need to pay yourself. You need to price your products appropriately, whether you're selling hand-spun yarn or you're selling a crochet good or a pattern design or a hand-dyed hank of yarn. You need to price yourself so that not only you are within an appropriate margin for the price that you're paying for your goods, but that you're also paying yourself. I was guilty of underpricing myself when I first began my business because I wasn't certain of my own skill level. And that's because I'm very hard on myself, but you shouldn't underprice yourself because you're new, and you shouldn't underprice yourself because you're very critical of your own skill. If you're doing things correctly, if you're following safety protocols, you're setting, like say you're an indie dyer, you want to dye yarn. You are following correct procedure, you're purchasing high quality yarn, you are properly, you know, setting your dyes and processing your fiber or whatever else you're dyeing, and you have your labels and everything, you know, you are professional. You are creating something that other people are going to use to make things like hats or mittens or scarves, like things that they're going to keep and love. So when you're building your product, don't undervalue yourself just because you're new at it. You know, if you are doing things the way that they're supposed to be done, you're a professional, you act professionally, whether you think your skill is good enough or not should not be in the pricing point. You need to pay yourself for the time that's spent. You need to pay yourself for the product that you're purchasing and reselling, so the prices of your bases and dyes, you know, and then, you know, you need to decide what your final margin is going to be. Do you want to do wholesale? Do you want to be able to price your products so that you can actually make money when you are wholesaling? Like, these are questions to ask yourself as you are building your business. For me, I knew that I underpriced myself at the beginning, and I definitely corrected that. But I still feel, for me, that the pricing of my yarn is still slightly on the lower end of where I want it to be. And also my bases, the prices just went up. So I am going to have to raise my price to maintain my margins, but I'm not worried about that right now. I'm trying to advise you. So you need to pay yourself. For me, I charge an appropriate amount so that I can pay for the goods that I'm selling. So pay for my bare bases, my dyes, you know, my equipment. So I've invested in a lot of equipment. I invested in a skein winder. I invested in a warping loom. I've invested in a spin dryer. I've invested in pans and storage equipment, office equipment, things that are going to make it more pleasurable for me to produce yarn. So I've taken that in as a cost, but I price my yarn appropriately so that I can pay off that cost within a reasonable time frame, and also put money away to save to invest back into my business. So at this point in my business, I'm investing a lot back into the business. Most of everything goes back into the business. I got a message from a girl who was like, "Oh, you seem so successful. Can you make lots of money? You know, can you make a living doing this?" And I said, "Well, my goal right now isn't to make money. My goal is to make my business better, to produce more yarn, to produce better quality yarn, I guess. I don't know, like be more adventurous, to bring new inspiration to the field. But all my money goes back into the business." So yes, you can make money. I suppose if you are just selling yarn to sell yarn and to not change your business. But you want to be able to structure your business so that you can appropriately scale and so you can appropriately make it to the goals that you want. So just like I said at the beginning, you know, you want to think about yourself when you're building your business. You want to think about what goals you have for yourself in your business. Do you want to just consign yarn? Do you want to just sell to customers? Do you want to just do shows? Do you want to just wholesale? You don't have to just do one or any of those things, but you want to have a clear picture in your head of what you want to see your business grow to. Do you want to see your business grow? And so for me, I do. So that's how I've structured myself. And then the last thing that I'd want to say is that don't forget why we are all here. My thought process when I'm answering these questions, because I do answer them quite frequently, is to push home the point that we are all here to create and inspire. We are here as artists. We are here as fiber artists, particularly, to create wonderful things that inspire others to also create. You know, handmade craft gets such a negative connotation. People think people who are not involved directly with doing handmade crafts, you know, tend to cheapen what you're doing. Oh, can you make me that for free? Oh, can you make me this huge Afghan? I'll pay you $50. They don't understand the time and effort that goes into it. So us as makers, creators, dyers, spinners, we are creating things that inspire others to make and to value what they make. You know, that's my goal as a a human and as a fiber artist, to really just inspire other people and to bring the love of the fiber arts, not just to my generation, but to generations to follow and generations that have already passed me. You know, whether you're older than I am or younger than I am, I'm kind of in the middle here. I want everybody to be able to enjoy my yarn. I dye pretty string. That's what I do. I use my creativity. I don't put pressure on myself and I just let it out. And I just think, wow, I love these things and I want to dye based on these wonderful things. That's how I run my business. And so I want to remind you of that mission where we are all here to create. We are not here to compete. We are competition for each other, but not a single person, not a single dyer or a single spinner or a single crocheter can meet the demand of the entire population. You cannot meet the demand of every, I cannot meet the demand of every crocheter with the yarn that I dye, but I can create beautiful yarn for crocheters who would like to use it. And I don't see myself in competition with other dyers because I see myself as an individual that is creating something unique and that I'm going to price myself into the market. I'm going to treat myself with respect and my colleagues with respect and lift them up because that lifts me up as well. And it lifts the entire community up. So I want to bring that to you. If you want to start a fiber arts business, whether you're designing or crocheting, knitting, spinning, whatever it is, do it. Take it seriously. It's a business. Lift up your competition, your colleagues. Create, share information. You know, there's a lot of things that don't get shared, you know, like specific dye recipes or the source of yarn or whatever source of dyes. Stuff just fell right behind the camera. I'm sorry if you heard that. But it's because we've all worked very hard to get to the places that we are in our business. And we don't want to cheapen that. You know, I share information. I get my yarn bases wholesale. There are several large wholesale distributors that provide bare bases. I use a distributor that is cruelty-free, that they source their merino that from farms that don't practice mulesing, and that are soft and lovely and meet the needs of my consumers, my customers, my friends. And I get my dyes from Dharma. Dharma has a ton of acid dyes. You can get dyes from Jacquard. You can get dyes from Prochem. That's the word I'm looking for. Prochem has Sabreset, Lanisette dyes. You can use food dyes. You know, there's a whole bunch of information out there. There are a million different techniques that you can use to speckle your yarn or to paint your yarn or to dip your yarn, to make a gradient, to make self-striping. You know, you want to work and you want to learn those things for yourself. And you should want to grow as a person. I don't want to ask another dyer and say, hey, how do you dye that self-striping? And expect them to tell me step by step how they did it. I want to learn it. I will pay for a class. I will pay someone to teach me the skill because their time is valuable, because their knowledge is valuable. I don't see asking questions as bad, but I don't expect to get all the answers by asking a question. You know, I will ask other dyers their opinions of bases or companies or dyes, but I don't say, hey, what is that dye you used to make that one colorway that everybody loves? Because I want to make it myself. Like, there's a difference there. Do you understand what I'm saying? So just remember, we're all there to lift each other up. If you're asking the right questions in the right place at the right time to the right people, I know it sounds like, you know, you need to have the serendipitous moment, but, you know, you're asking a question to your colleagues out of respect, and you're asking a question to your colleagues with the goal of building your skill and not necessarily stealing from them, stealing knowledge or stealing, what's the word I'm looking for? It's one thing to ask, you know, what brand of dyes do you use versus, or what brand of dyes do you like versus what are the exact colors and methods you use to dye this one hank of yarn? You know, we should all be wanting to lift each other up. We do share knowledge. We do share skills. We do all of that, but we do it with respect for one another. We do it not to crush a competition or to create gains for our own business. We do it and we share this information so that we all can grow together and we all can learn together. There are several groups on Facebook that deal with particularly dyeing yarn or particularly deal with spinning or selling handspun or selling fiber. And, you know, we're all there to help learn from each other's mistakes, to help guide each other if you're in a difficult situation with a customer, or, you know, if you're having trouble with a specific dye or, you know, a specific technique and you're trying to troubleshoot something, there's information available. But there's a difference between asking somebody the specific dyes that they put into this one hank of yarn and how they did it versus saying like, hey, what brand of dyes do you like or recommend? You know, there are certain things that are easily shared, and then there are certain things that just take time to learn and to learn a new skill. Like, I will pay for a class. I will pay someone to teach me a skill if I know that they're very good at that skill, you know, because I value their time and their efforts as well, and I'm not a person to just expect getting that for free. So, but the main message here is that we're all creators. We're all here to make beautiful things and to lift each other up and to inspire each other to create more. And so that's why I encourage you, if you do want to start a fiber arts business, definitely do it. But keep those things in mind. Take it seriously. Look to yourself for inspiration, set realistic goals, and really make your business about yourself and what you love to do. So I hope you guys enjoyed this video. If you did, please give it a thumbs up. Subscribe to my YouTube channel if you do want to see more videos like this. I'm going to try and keep uploading as consistently as I possibly can, so please bear with me. And I'm glad that whoever has stuck around here has done so, and I'm happy to see some new subscribers coming in. So welcome. I hope you enjoy this channel, and I hope you find it informative and fun and inspirational. So until next time, I'll see you guys later. Bye!